cut his run short and now making all the way back to the finals, another chance at a world championship.
Yeah, Pavel was really close last year of qualifying for BlizzCon at the European Championships, and everyone can remember a year back that he made this crazy mistake against Life Coach that ended up costing the series, and of course his chance at BlizzCon. A really soul-crushing defeat, if you will. Pavel was really upset because, you know, it was an uncomfortable situation. Come a year later, he is four games away from being able to go to BlizzCon. RDU 2014 had a breakout performance at all these tournaments, acquired all these points that he couldn't even actually go to because Romania was not eligible. This year he is. Both these players want to prove something. Both these players bring the lineups that they're both convinced is going to work. And I love the fact that these guys have their own choices on stuff. RDU loves to bring his own Zoo deck. He has his own style. He loves to bring his own decks. Pavel bringing his own influence of stuff. Who is playing Dark Arakoa in Druid? Who's the one bringing Temple Mage amongst the sea of Freeze Mages? This guy's bringing his own choices of stuff, too. The Temple Mage that we see is uncanny. I really love that Pavel's bringing his own style, and he is an extremely scary player because of just how different he is from everyone else.
And almost every single, a lot of classes being represented in this final as well. I believe 7 total classes. We're only missing Paladin and Priest as far as class representation in the final. So we got a lot of diversity going into as well, along with interesting choices, like you mentioned, on current decks. Let's go ahead and talk about Pavel a little bit more, one of our finalists here in his road. One of the top point earners for the season with 95, 70 points from ladder. But he's been sort of quiet as far as the tournament front has gone. No points from majors, very little points from championships.
Yeah, I'd like to point out that Pavel doesn't really enter many of those big tournaments that you see all the time happening. There's no real DreamHack run that he had or Star Ladder, for example. Instead, he chooses to go through primarily ladder and play in those cups every now and then to keep up the pace. You can see that he's also one of those players that plays a ton of games. Pavel's logged tens of thousands of games, and that's partially what makes him really scary, because he's one of those players that's played so much Hearthstone, and he understands what makes every deck tick. The scariest players, in my opinion, are ones that are not known for specific deck, because they're the ones that you know that can play everything. They're Swiss Army knives. And what makes Pavel, in my opinion, the complete threat is that he's also willing to extend beyond the norm. He has these interesting cards that you don't really expect to play, and so as a result, you have to account for him differently from other players because he makes all these tech choices that people wouldn't play in normal tournaments.
Yeah, and you know, speaking of his road to get to this finals and just this tournament alone, having one of the toughest roads out of any player here, having to defeat Hoy and George C, as you saw in that last matchup, which are two of the most well-respected players in all of Europe right now. George C because of his performances this year across the Hearthstone Championship Tour, Hoy because of his performances, you know, in the past few years with many top six, top four finishes in a lot of major tournaments. So Pavel definitely proving himself so far today. Is there a weak link? Is there a deck that maybe RDU can pressure? What are we looking for as far as his performance going to the finals?
It's tricky because Temple Mage is one of those decks you live and die by. You have some players who just think it's not good. It's just, in their words, it's trash because it feels like it's so inconsistent based off its openings. Your win percentages vary so much based off your opening hand, and even just having the coin can influence so much the decisions of the series and outcomes. Not to mention that he also has a very different list. He has 2 Firelands Portals and 2 Arcane Anomalies, no one really plays that. And he also has strict Yogg's run from his deck because of the recent change in patches. There's a lot of things that really come into Pavel's lineup that are big question marks, but it's gotten him this far, and you have to kind of admit, it's actually really cool that someone's able to still innovate, whether how big or how small, depends on the viewer's perspective. You've gotten him this far to the finals.
Yeah, I mean, we look at even Dr. Hippie throughout his road to the Summer Championship had Temple Mage, his lineup, a player that brought Freeze Mage forever. Pavel also a player that's been known to play some Freeze Mage, but like you said, Swiss Army Knife of Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Can play anything. Freeze Mage was just that little swirly thing that comes off the end.
And I love that Pavel's also part of the Russian community. I know it's not something he's in control of because it is his heritage, but the fact that the Russian community doesn't get enough representation in general, they're a very strong group of players. They all represent a huge portion of the European scene. If you just look at ladder and look at the top 100 finishes, there's many Russian players. They're very good at Hearthstone, but just because they don't speak English and connect to the rest of the West, you can see that the community is growing a lot. They're playing a lot of games. They have their own celebrities in their own right. Look at guys like Silvername and some of these other Russian players really rising up through the ranks. It doesn't surprise me that Pavel's been able to go through all the process once again and come one step away from qualifying for BlizzCon. And what a story again it would be to come back the following year after being able, after coming back from that terrible mistake. And imagine if he was able to go even further than BlizzCon.
It would be the ultimate redemption for him. But we have some friends across the studio that might have some thoughts to weigh in on the situation. Hello, Sadal and Savitz, all the way over at the caster desk. What have been your thoughts on Pavel so far, Sadal? I want you to go ahead and kick it off there.
Well, I mean, first of all, I'm just amazed that the wonder of modern technology allows us to communicate from just this far away. It's
high
incredible.
Five, yeah.
Hey!
Went with that as well as I expected it to be.
Yeah, it's a solid 3 out of 10 high five, I think.
I don't know what else I was expecting.
Pavel, incredibly solid player. You know, I've said a lot about him already. He's someone I've had on my friends list for a long time, and I've kind of followed his ladder finishes and so on. Incredibly strong player, and I personally like his Tempo Mage list. I'm one of those people that Dan was talking about that thinks Tempo Mage is a pretty trash tier deck. But if I was going to subject myself to Tempo Mage, this is the list I'd play. Like, just full of minions, grab the board early, keep it, beat people up, kill them with rag.
No Cabalist
Tomes.
So.
No Cabalist Tome. I wasn't going to go there, Dan. You went there for me.
Faceless Summoner is kind of like the Cabalist Tome of minions, though.
Can be, but at the same time, it's a really powerful tempo play. I think a lot of people can agree upon.
Yeah.
I want to ask Savitz too. You know, you've been able to watch Pavel for a long time, both as an observer and watching him compete. And you mentioned that he is one of the scariest players. You want to elaborate why exactly he's scary to you?
Yeah, because of the deck list. Because quite often when I'm playing on in ladder, I know that if I see a warrior, I know what it's gonna be. But it wasn't more than a couple of months ago that there was a Pavel's dragon control warrior list, which was something that I never seen before, and he was top 10 legend with it. I was really impressed. I tried playing it, and I didn't quite have the same success, but he certainly had made it work. And another thing about Pavel is that he hasn't made a big impact on the scene, and probably lately, and probably a lot of viewers back at home don't know him, but I certainly do. I've known him for years from ladder, from tournaments. Just watching him play is a pleasure, and I think he's gonna put a tough match.
I feel like I've known him for years because me and him play really similarly. We both play exceptionally well.
Do you do realize that?
I was gonna say that's a hell of a compliment to be giving yourself, TJ. The guy in the finals, I play just like him.
Yeah, you know, I was about to say, because, you know, Pavel is actually also known to love playing Priest a lot. It's a really interesting thing because Pavel is primarily a control lover. He's brought Handlock a lot. He's brought Priest a lot. But it's fascinating because I thought you said you identify with him, but you don't really play Priest, TJ.
Dan, you don't know me.
You play Control Warrior with Hobgoblins in it, and you play Zoo with Yogg-Saron in it. That tells me that's TJ in a nutshell, everybody.
Don't judge a book by its cover.
Or a caster by their hair.
We're going to use modern technology once again to make Sol and Savitz's beer. We'll check in with you guys in just a little bit here. Yeah, but let's go ahead and talk about the second player. We hammered home Pavel a little bit, but RDU. RDU is a player that a lot of people were hyping up coming into this, including himself.
Yeah.
He's,
well said.
Yeah, he's a player that has a pretty good mix of points. You know, he's got a lot of ladder points. He's the highest total point earner of any player that didn't qualify for a championship, and 15 points from a major, of course, with his win at DreamHack Summer. Dan, tell me more about RDU.
I think RDU is actually a person with true passion. I think we use the term passion a little bit too loosely in the gaming community. When you're excited about something, people say it's very passionate. But RDU is actually a person that truly does put the game's interest and everything about it above himself in a lot of capacities, because he just really loves what Hearthstone's been able to do, not just for him, but also for his team and also everybody of his group of friends. This guy comes in as a player who's been doubted since the beginning. When he started winning his first tournament, there was a lot of shade on whether or not his results were legitimate, just because they felt like he wasn't a player that was deserving of a lot of credit. And through years of repetition, of being able to beat people over the head with results and consistency and a lot of effort, honestly, you can just see by the number of points he's able to gather with Open Cups. This guy has definitely proven himself by brute force that he belongs with the best. And it doesn't really surprise anybody to see that he's in the finals But at the same time, he still has some kind of chip on his shoulder for some reason. He always feels like he has to prove himself. And I think him getting to this point is definitely something to be proud of. But at the same time, something that he shouldn't settle for because he knows what he ultimately wants. RU's always dreamed from the very first day. He's always told me every time we've ever talked about how he wants to be the best. He wants to be known to be the best, and he wants people to respect him for that. And he needs to win this series and go to BlizzCon in order to get close to that, because the problem is, if he wins here, we go to the Hearthstone World Championship and kind of forget about people's runs, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. He needs to go that further, that extra step. But once he does, I think he can cement himself as one of Hearthstone's greatest.
Yeah, another thing to point out is that he sort of watched Tice have all this success over the course of 2015 Europe Championship, into the World Championship last year, now qualifying again. Mm-hmm. And he sort of like sat on the sidelines, you know, supporting him, practicing with him, not having that success for himself. So it just sort of adds on to, you know, that looming, whatever it is behind him, pushing him towards the World Championship. It's like a shadow.
I mean, it is a little bit of a shadow because of the way Life Coach and Tice, who are well celebrated both for their BlizzCon runs, also just from their Stormin' of Championships. But remember, it was RDU who proved himself first among the group of three, and yet because of the way 2015's streak was not able to, basically RDU had a pretty unfortunate 2015, just not able to kind of piece runs together, left behind by the rest of his teammates who also were able to do a lot of accomplishments. But he was also an integral part of their victory in the Archon Team League. He was able to also help them practice a lot, and every time Tyson and Life Coach had a victory, they're always thanking Radu, and they're always thanking him and trying to put him in the spotlight. It's really time for the fans to continue to embrace him as part of the power of the trio, because for a long time it was a duo concern when RDU's been there, also strong, and I feel like it's his time to shine. I really do feel like that RDU at this point is ready to take the finals.
Yeah, and a lot of people, I think, became fans of competitive Hearthstone or maybe even got into Hearthstone after RDU's initial success with Hearthstone. So it's interesting to see those players and how they feel about him moving forward to the finals. But let's once again check in with our good friends over at the desk, Sottl and Svitz. Svitz, man, RDU, I know you've been around the competitive scene for a while as well with him. What have been your thoughts on his run so far and his chances of going to the finals?
I mean, it has been mentioned a lot, but I really can't honestly name a single person who would work harder than RDU for this, and I think he would be a great champion and well-deserving one. It's just it's just crazy how much effort he puts into preparing for tournaments, grinding the points from Open Cups, finishing high on ladder, all that. And yes, he's surrounded by a great group of players, so practicing together also puts him in a good spot.
Yeah, I mean, he's shown an impressive run here. And Sottl, I know that you and RDU share some maybe not so similar philosophies on a lot of things, but have you respected him as a player over the course of his run into the finals now for LASCAL?
I mean, that's exactly what I wanted to talk about. I think Dan did an amazing job of, you know, talking about RDU's history and his motivations moving forward. But I just want to specifically outline that today he has played as well, like as good a day of Hearthstone as I've ever seen a tournament player have. His match with the Shaman against the Control Warrior was perfect, the perfect amount of pressure, holding back to beat Brawl, and then played Rogue against the Control Warrior, and he blocked a Harrison Jones turn with a questing adventurer that looked bizarre, and it turned out that extra damage that he got through without getting Harrison was just exactly what he needed at the end. Like, RDU is playing close to perfect at this point, and I think that is just the culmination that everything that Dan was talking about, where, you know, this, he knows this is his moment, and he is not a man that chokes under pressure. He's a man that rises to pressure, and he is playing the best Hearthstone of his life today.
All right, well, we're almost about to get into the finals, so let's go ahead and get all of our predictions. We're going to start all the way down the line here. Svitz, who are you predicting to make it to the World Championship from the Europe Last Call?
It's going to be a 4-3, but I think this might be RDU's moment. This is what he's been waiting for so long, and I think it's his time to shine.
All right, Sottl?
Yeah, Radu, I just want to see someone get rewarded for playing as well as he has done today, so I'm going to go for RDU as well.
Wow. So far unanimous, Frodan?
You know, I mean, it feels kind of silly to just jump on the train here and not really offer any kind of discourse or devil's advocate here, but I do feel like the year's worth of hard work for RDU, definitely not only just putting out the points there, but also trying to champion just the points leader and really trying to put himself out there and show that being the number one seed actually is meaningful to a large degree. I really hope that RDU is able to pull it out through. So I'm picking RDU, but I don't think it's going to be 4-3. I think it's going to be a pretty convincing victory in some capacity, either 4-1 or 4-0.
All right, I think we have a historic moment here in the history of caster predictions for the end of a series. I'm also going to pick RDU.
No,
so we have a unanimous four-way
RDU. We've doomed him, guys.
Oh, man. But, yeah, I think maybe Hizu might be a weak link. But other than that, I feel like he's in a great spot. Played very well today, as Sato mentioned, as you've mentioned earlier. So definitely going to be a fun finals to look forward to. But the stage is set. It's about that time, guys. So, boys, Sato and Savitz, take it away for the finals.
Thank you, TJ. So there we have it. Tice, Naaman, Dr. Hippie, these are our Europe representatives for BlizzCon so far. While those guys have been showing up to championships and winning these high-profile events, the eight guys in this tournament have been grinding away behind the scenes, and they now have to fight out for the one last spot, more specifically these two guys you see in front of you, Pavel and RDU. One final look at the lineups here. Yep. Anything that stands out to you in particular about the matchups?
Not really. The ban's no surprise here. RDU is a rogue getting banned away again, and RDU banning Pavel's shaman. That tempo mage is going to be free, and I'm really interested to see how it works out, because it is so different from the other tempo mage that we are used to seeing after Yogg-Saron got introduced, because it has kind of been like the centerpiece of that deck. That's your end game in case you don't finish your opponent early on early enough, and having those Kabbalist tomes kind of to sustain yourself. He is not playing any Kabbalist Tomes, so he has to make something else happen.
Yeah, what's it? It seems like a natural response, right? If you want to continue playing Tempo Mage, he's cut out a lot of the mid-game spell stuff with the Kabbalist Tome, and he's packing in more minions. He's playing Water Elementals and Faceless Summoners. Yeah. So if you're not going to be relying so heavily on spells, then and suddenly packing in all these value minions seem like a good strategy moving forward. But it remains to be seen how powerful that build is moving forward. But definitely a lot more aggressive, a lot more focused than we've seen some of the Tempo Mage builds coming out. But I also want to talk about RDU's Zoo deck. And I think since the nerf came out, not really that Zoo lost a lot of power level. Sure, it had one of its best cards nerfed in Abusive Sergeant, but not to the point where it's unplayable. Abusive Sergeant's still a very strong card. But I think a lot of the trickle-down effect of the meta of Freeze Mage becoming powerful because they prey on the new slower shamans, for example. Like, lots of byproducts like that have made Zoo a lot weaker than it once was. Are you surprised to see a Zoo in the grand finals? Do you think it could be a weak link for RDU?
I think it might be. That's a good matchup for it too. If he gets it against the warrior maybe doesn't have a fiery war axe. If he gets it up against a druid, maybe a druid has a slow start. Druid AoE tends to be very weak, so he might be able to flood the board in a way where a druid cannot answer that. Against the rogue, it's going to be a little bit tricky. Against the mage, anything can happen. It depends who has the early tempo, and the early turns especially are going to be key in that one.
Yeah, it remains to be seen. I think if anything, maybe the minion-heavy tempo mage deck is a little bit weaker against Zoo even, because you don't consistently get those blowout turns with the removal spells, because generally the way tempo mage would win that matchup is just kind of stall, and then one big swing turn with a Cold Sorcerer or a Flame Waker in the mid-game. So they've just got a handful of like Water Elementals and Faceless Summoners. It might not work out too well, but yeah, RDU obviously a ton of faith in Zoo. He thinks, with very good reason, that he is one of the strongest Zoo players in the world. He plays that deck incredibly well. All the positional concerns, specifically knowing which particular one drops he wants in his hand, in which matchups, how to play a curve with the coin, where to, use that mana for a quick burst. So if anyone can pilot Zoo successfully, I think it's going to be Radu.
I completely agree. I couldn't name a better Zoo player in the world. The RDU, if not the best, he's definitely up there. He's a great Zoo player. He knows exactly what he needs to do in every single matchup. And that's also something for maybe some viewers back at home. Like, that deck is extremely cheap. There's not even a single legendary, so if you want to try to craft a really strong deck, that might be an option, even if you don't have all the cards. And RDU is going to be the player to learn it from. So it's going to be very educational also to be watching him play that.
Sure, hope so, but we're looking one more time at how these players reached here, or how the road brought them here. Pavel, again, huge chunk of points from ladder. Little splash into the Open Cup scene, picking up 20 points there as well, but primarily a ladder monster, as we've all talked about at length. A top 10 and just outside the top 10 finish consecutively in April and May, which is Pretty incredible when you consider how competitive these ladder seasons have been. You know, I remember seeing Pavel, you know, taking rank one at ease, or honestly, like several years ago. But that was during a point where the ladder wasn't quite as competitive as it is now, because there wasn't really any end game reward to doing well on ladder. So still being able to compete in the top 10 is a huge achievement. And there you see RDU with a much more balanced pie chart, with the splash of majors in there as well. Open Cup's about the same level, and then still those 71 ladder points, putting him far and away the points leader overall. And what's amazing, and what is a similar story when we get to the Americas Last Call Invitational later on next week, is that the points leaders have done it without that kind of artificial boost that you get from being in one of the championships.
Exactly. And here we go. Game one underway of these finals. It's going to be RDU Zoo-Walla going up against Pavel's Tempo Mage. And like I said, the early turns are going to be absolutely critical for this one. And both players are right now looking at decent hands. Actually, really good hands.
Is double Mana Worm Arcane Missiles good?
I would say that's good.
Colon thinking, colon.
But Faceless Summoner is not that great, though. And so Pavel might be whiffing out on the turn 3 and 4. Maybe if he misses a play there, that can be something that he can't really recover from.
Right. So now suddenly, RDU has to play a game of removal roulette in his hand. You know, he has to consider all the options. Frostbolt, Arcane Blast, you know, Mirror Image even is a relevant card. Arcane Missiles as well. And you make a play that is strong against the most of them possible. And he's going to go for the line here. And now Arcane Missiles is going to come
huge.
Out. Such a high percentage to be able to take out this 1-3 here. Just needs
what if it goes
a single shot on it.
Oh,
even better.
That was incredible. It actually took out the Flaming, but now RDU. Oh no, he really wanted to have that alive and to be able to trade with at least one of the Mana Worms, but now he can't really find a trade. No Direwolf available, no abusives in the deck.
I just want to pause proceedings for a second and ask, what kind of man is Pavel? Because he has one golden and one regular Faceless Summoner in his deck. This is an unforgivable sin, and I think we should disqualify him from this tournament immediately.
I think it's a punishment enough to be drawing it in the starting hand of the finals.
Yeah,
so
that's fair.
Right now, Pavel does not have a play. Well, okay, there's a play. Maybe not the best one, but it does buff both of the Mana Worms, so that's something.
There's no real reason to use it, though, right? He can just ping and double trade, and you know, Zoo doesn't really fight from off the board too well, so it doesn't really matter about the lost value on your Mana Worms. Like, the only thing that can affect this board is Knife Juggler, and even then it would have to be a lucky shot. So I would expect to see the Arcane Blast held onto in case there's no play available for Pavel next turn as well.
I would just go for it, because it is 2 damage immediately through those Mana Worms, so that's quite a bit. And I was actually mistaken there by saying that RDU doesn't run any abusive Surgeon. There is one in the deck.
Interesting. Pavel choosing to just take the really aggressive line here and, you know, disrespect the possibility for RDU to trade. And I imagine a huge part of that is the fact that there is only one abusive in the deck, and abusive is the primary punish there in that situation.
Whoops, there's two. Okay.
Savitz, please! Savitz!
There are two. Okay, but anyway, moving on. There's the Blood Mage coming down, and and a hero power, not what Pavel was hoping for turn 4, but again, at least he has a play, not just playing, waiting for that turn 6. Could have been worse, he could have drawn something like a Firelands portal there.
I trusted you, man.
I feel
betrayed, honestly.
I trusted me too.
Yeah, Blood Mage, not the greatest pickup, but it's all about kind of just filling turns at this point. If he can continue being aggressive and at least do something passable on each turn leading into these Faceless Summoners, then just the raw stats on the board is going to represent a very imposing situation for RDU to deal with.
Yeah, this is looking like a nightmare for RDU right now. He's down to 14 HP already from those Mana Worms. And Pavel is running a lot of burn. There's double Firelands portal. There's obviously 2 fireballs, 2 frostbolts, all of that burn. I mean, if there was a fireball, it would go extremely low already.
Wow.
Water elemental. Okay, well, that's something to play, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, the problem is he traded into the Darkshire Councilman there with the likely intention of maybe taking a trade ping with the Mana Worm and looking for something to play alongside it, or drawing a spell and then getting the buff on the Mana Worm and trading in that way. Water elemental does neither of those things, so from this point, it looks like he's just going to try and play minions and hope that enough of them stick that he can dig in some damage to face here and finish out the game.
Seems like it. RDU here. That Doom God looks quite tempting with the Silver Golem, but there is that tiny chance that if he went for that play, that the Silver War Golem would not get on the board. And by playing the two jugglers here, he makes sure that the Doom God will get the Silver on the board. And not only that, but he's getting two juggles from that Impgang boss.
Yep, needs a juggle to hit the War Elemental. That is not a good face from RDU. I think they've both gone face. They have. It means the Water Elemental lives here. That's another potential 3 damage to his face if Pavel's on the race plan. But now that he's lost the board against Zhu, a pile of minions is not what you want in this situation because Zhu is just able to chew them up one by one. That's what Zhu does when they've established a board presence.
Yeah, like RDU did get back on the board and he's going to be pulling even further ahead here. Soulfire, well, I can't play it. It gets discarded from the Doom God. You can't really risk it here. He could go for the Soulfire first if he was extremely greedy and then play the Doom God, but I mean, that's a risk you can't take. Just no way.
So if he Doomguards here, he still has plenty of damage to be able to clear up this board, right? So I don't really see the risk reward working out in his favor in terms of the Soulfire. So I agree with you. I'd like to see Doomguard just come down here, get your free 3-3 on the board, get two knives in the process. I guess he's just thinking about sequencing in terms of trades preemptively so that he can have greater control about where the knives go.
If he wants to first trade into those minions, maybe with the Councilman. I guess that's the only consideration here.
Right.
And how much does he wanna go for a face, and how much does he wanna trade for?
Yeah, I think potentially trading into the Water Elemental with the Councilman is reasonable. The freeze won't matter too much when it's just a ping target. Anyway, he's going for it!
So you get...
Oh no! And the punish is enormous. Pavel gets the news of just how big that 50-50 was as the Silverware Golem is played from hand. That is a huge risk from RDU. Did he need to take that, Savitz?
I don't know. I felt like he didn't, but RDU, I guess, feels that he's so low on HP that he has to go for some kind of gamble. A little bit crumbling there. Is it the pressure getting to him or what? Because he played the Silverware Golem before life tapping. I don't really see the reason for that. He could have potentially picked up a better 3-mana card than the Silver Golem to play instead of it.
That is a Argent Horse Rider, which means this could be a potential pretty big clear here, but he'll take 3 to face as well. That's perfectly fine in this situation. It means he can just dig the damage, and now any fireball that is drawn at any point this game is going to be lethal for Pavel as long as he lives alive long enough to tell the tale. RDU has no answer to the board. He's going to give it up. And the Tempo Mage deck that I said might be even weaker against Zhu actually comes out off the back, firstly, of a crushing double Mana Worm start.
And the Arcane Missiles.
And the Arcane Missiles. But secondly, off a questionable high-risk play from RDU.
That was weird. I did not expect something like that from RDU. Like, I don't feel like he necessarily had to take the risk there. But even then after that, you saw him just go for the Silverware and then tap at the end of the turn. If he went for the tap first, maybe he picks up an Impgang boss, maybe another Soulfire, maybe the 2-mana card that like discards your card.
Darkshield Librarian.
Thank you. Yeah. He could have picked that up and played that and to get the Silverware on the board. There was so many things wrong with that. I think RDU may be a little bit nervous.
Well, let's take a minute. We'll mull it over. You guys can mull it over and we will discuss that play in more detail after this. Welcome back, guys, to the grand finals of the Europe Last Call Invitational, the last chance for a European player to guarantee themselves a spot at BlizzCon. And I'm still reeling. I think you're still reeling from the conclusion to that Zhu game there. I mean, from a man that's been playing so well this entire day, it's possible that he was just operating on a further plane of existence than I'm on there. And you know, maybe we've missed something. If we have, please tweet at me, tell me what was going on. But it just looked like such an unnecessary risk.
It really did. And I think it might be the pressure. There's so much on the line here. To get to BlizzCon and to play for that $1 million prize pool is so huge. This is what he worked for all year long. So a little bit of a nervous play there from RDU, I feel like, and I hope that he won't be kicking himself and over that for the rest of the series, just thinking about it when it's already done. Just get over it as fast as possible, and focus on the next game. It's not going to be easy, but I hope he can do it.
So, new matchup on the boards, Rogue versus Hunter here. RDU trying to fight back with the Hunter deck, but Pavel with a strong-looking opening here with the Rogue deck. Has that Swashbuckler on one, picked up a pretty nice card with it in the form of the Infested Wolf. Yeah. And any hand against an aggressive board presence deck that contains the cards Preparation and Edwin Van Cleef usually puts you in a pretty strong position.
Yeah, but Pavel does know that RDU is running two copies of Deadly Shot in right. his Hunter. So that's very risky if you choose to go for it. I don't think you can do it just yet. Maybe just go for something like a 6-6 on next turn. Just mm-hmm. dagger here. Save the coin for later on. I think I like that a little bit more. Mm. Although we can see that there's no Deadly Shot, so if he just went for it, he would probably be doing quite well.
Yep, it's very possible, but you know, just that combination at some point could end up paying dividends. You know, if he can get, say, the Infested Wolf down on the board and then prep together a huge Edwin to go alongside the Infested Wolf, that plays around Deadly Shot because of how sticky that minion is. So definitely has the potential to move forward with that kind of line later on in the game. But as you said, playing into Deadly Shot on curve when there are two of them in a deck, a little bit risky.
Yeah.
But RDU just going to happily continue developing here. Animal Companion comes down. That is a Huffer. And I think this is just 7 damage downtown. Do you really mind about protecting your Huffer from face tank and the 1-1 here if the Rogue wants to slap into it with her face again?
I think you go face. I mean, how much do you care about that? Pavel is playing the Maluka Stroke too, so there won't be any Cold Blood Punish coming.
Right.
So I would imagine that it's just going to be 7 to face.
Yeah, it's such a minor difference in every world that clears this. You know, even Fan of Knives, for example, it's a difference of 1 damage if you do get punished. So yeah, just sending the damage to face definitely seems correct.
Second prep would be so good here. Oh, just 0 mana.
It costs 0. That's good enough.
Yeah, I thought it was a preparation. But it's still going to be amazing. He can just go for the backstab, prep the fan, use the dagger, get that huge Van Cleef out there. And not only that, this time he is protected against the Deadly Shot. It is going to be only a 50-50, even if RDU had it.
Oh, that is huge! That is a huge deal. That means that if Deadly Shot was in the hand for RDU, from Pavel's perspective, he is completely insured against that card now. Now only a 33% chance of hitting the target, and there it is.
I wouldn't be surprised if he just went for it.
I don't see how he wins the game if he doesn't try to Deadly Shot this 12-12. It's the correct play. 66% of the time you lose the game, but 100% of the time you lose the game if you don't Deadly Shot.
It's on his face. He's going for it. He is going for it. He knows he has to do it. It's only 1 in 3, but he has to try it. Does he get it? No.
Unlucky. Far right instead of far left. RDU didn't quite calibrate his aiming system correctly there, and now Pavel is just going to run a train over RDU with this 12 damage now.
Yeah, I don't think there's much RDU can do at this point. That Deadly Shot was all he had, and that high main not gonna do anything, and Animal Companion, even if it's a Misha, it's just a Doom Blizzard will trade into it. It might buy another turn, but.
Yep, seems like the line of play is bottom right. Click that button, and then it's the top option. RDU manages to find it. He finds the line, but on a serious note, like the Deadly Shot, you know, it looks a bit comical and whatever, and if it had come off, it would have perhaps looked even more ridiculous, but. The important thing is, you know the odds of that working. They're 33.3%, and you have to do it because 33% of the time you give yourself a chance to win the game. If you don't take that line, your win rate is roughly 0.
Yep, I completely agree. I mean, it might look pretty terrible, like using it there, like it's only 1 in 3, but you absolutely had to take the shot.
Yep. So RDU, now after following up that first performance where maybe there was a shaky turn towards the end, just a crushing win for Pavel means the momentum is building up for him, but I don't even really want to bother asking questions about RDU's tournament mentality because there is not really a more experienced man in terms of high-pressure situations, you know, dealing with the mentality that you need to make a comeback. So if anyone is equipped to just continue playing solid Hearthstone, even perhaps recovering from playing some suboptimal turns earlier on, I think you'll agree RDU is one of the men to do that.
Yeah, I certainly hope so. But even no matter how experienced he is, it's just a... It is tough, especially after that game 1, just trying to like reset the situation. he might be thinking he's in bad shape right now and start overthinking the plays. That's the most common mistake that I see, is when a player is kind of like, there is the obvious play, that kind of the one that you see first, and then you just like think about it, just trying to avoid mistake as possible, and then you see something weird and just think about the perfect card that would counter your first play. Mm-hmm. Usually the first instinct is correct when you play as much as RDU does, so I really hope he won't start overthinking.
I agree with you for the most part. You know, when you've played tens and tens and thousands of games, as all of these players have, essentially, you build up correct instincts over that time, right? Your mind is trained to recognize patterns, and without even really thinking about things, your brain says to you, okay, you've been in this situation, you know, 30 times before. Here's what you have to do in this situation, and you have to learn to trust that a lot of the time. So I agree with you, overthinking can be a problem, but RDU needs to make something happen here, because Pavel is very quickly putting his wins on the board. So his remaining decks now, the Malagos Druid, one of the most powerful decks in the game, sure, can be expected to get a win fairly comfortably here, but also the C'Thun Warrior. How does the C'Thun Warrior line up against RDU?
I'm not sure. Like, the C'Thun Warrior is something that has also not been that popular lately. I mean, it is a strong deck. It's especially good in beating aggressive strategies, so I think it might do quite well against the Zoo if it just gets the couple of important early game cards. It can fall really far behind if you don't get the Fire War Axe and the Ravaging Ghoul, maybe to kind of do some cleanup if you don't get the Revenge at the right time. But I think all the tools are there to beat the Zoo Warlock, and maybe even like the... Well, Hunter is always going to be difficult, but I think there's even a small chance to beat that one.
Yeah, I think against Zoo, C'Thun Warrior has so many great additional tools. Obviously, they have the Fiery War Axe and the Revenges and Brawls and all these classic tools that we know are strong against aggro. But, you know, even just things like C'Thun's Chosen on turn 4, for example. Divine Shield minion, really, right, really hard for Zoo to interact with correctly. And then the extra late game stability with the Vec'Lore and the Shield Bearer being able to just wall themselves out of rough situations. I think C'Thun Warrior has a very decent chance against some of these aggressive decks for sure. But just give you guys a quick update. Pavel has just gone for a quick bathroom break. I think RDU has gone for a quick bathroom break. I apologize. So we are just waiting for him to return while he's composing himself a little bit. But yeah, so C'Thun Warrior, probably good against the aggressive strategies. How about this kind of wonky build of Malagos Druid that Pavel is packing here with the Dark Arakoas in it?
Like where did the Arakoas come from? Only Pavel is a player who would do something like that. If I heard that one player was bringing some cards like that nobody else was playing, I could have guessed that it is Pavel. And yeah, I mean, it costs one less than an Ancient of War, and it only has three less toughness, so I guess it makes sense.
Seems logical. I mean, it is just a very, very high quality minion. Yeah? It's very nicely statted for its mana cost. It's just not really something you've seen too much outside of C'Thun decks. The occasional appearance in some heavy wall ramp druid style thing, but not in this kind of combo Malagos deck. But RDU here queuing in his Hunter now against this this Malagos Druid, this unique Malagos Druid. So hopefully we get to see if Dark Arakoa can do some work here for Pavel.
Yeah, Pavel did get an Innervate, and he also has a Mire Keeper. I'm interested to see if he just chooses to go for it right here. He wouldn't really have a play for it. Just going Hero Power could work, actually. Or he could just go for the Innervate Mire Keeper too. The Fandral I don't like one bit, because there could be something like a Quick Shot and then the Fiery Bat, and Quick Shot would deal too easily with the Fandral.
He also just has no upside on Fandral either. Like, even if it sticks, he has nothing to pay it off afterwards, so it doesn't really seem that worth it. RDU here just going to push face, it looks like, with the Fiery Bat. That does give Pavel potentially an opportunity to increase the odds in his favor of some favorable juggles here from these early Hunter minions. But on 3 mana, he's unlikely to be able to develop a secondary minion to change the equation on this Mire Keeper getting sniped down. So definitely don't mind RDU taking the aggressive line.
Yeah, he didn't want to take the risk there. He would have been kind of rewarded for it, because now Pavel won't need that Feral Rage necessarily. He can just Hero Power and trade for the huge Toad.
Yep. And he'll be hoping to tank this one onto the 3-3 Mire Keeper. Gets it as well. So, yep, just mitigating a little bit of damage there. Every little helps. And he's going to be able to develop Fandral on the board on the following turn. And now he does have some upside to following that up potentially with the Feral Rage.
Yep. Swipe is looking quite all right, too. How about Fandral? No, Fandral, no good. Just gonna go for the swipe. Doesn't expect RDU to be going too wide on the board.
9 mana Call of the Wild. We are a long way away from that, but there are two very sticky minions being developed into play now. The Squire and the Horse Rider being able to push through from RDU. And Pavel having just used a swipe, these Divine Shields and the 1 health of these minions per potentially able to get a lot more value than usual. But Living Roots is a pretty nice answer to this board state.
Yeah, it certainly is. It doesn't remove the minion straight away, but with that bundle, he also gets the 1/1s, and those 1/1s are going to be trading so efficiently.
Sure are, and that Call of the Wild does have a even bigger impact being drawn this early than it looks like, because obviously it's a little ugly to draw a 9-mana card this early on in the game, but it's also blocking him from ever drawing a card from that quick shot, essentially, by just being yeah. sat in his hand for 9-mana, so wouldn't be surprised to just use it, see RDU use that foursome initiative at some point if he doesn't, for example, pick up Savannah High Main on the next turn.
Yeah, that's kind of a weird combination of cards there. If he wants to draw a card with the quickshot, it won't be before turn 10. I would expect him to just use it to maybe remove a minion on the board. Or if he gets closer to lethal, maybe just draw it at his opponent's face. Healing Touch, Soul of the Forest. He does have those.
I mean, Innovate plays an 8-8 this turn. I feel that's probably the strongest choice.
But then there's the double deadly shot thing again. So I don't hate this.
That's a very good point.
He will still be able to play that giant next turn with this and kind of like upgrades his saplings into 2/2s.
That's a fair point. He's also seen this quick shot hanging around for a little while, so he could be giving credit to this to being deadly shot. There hasn't been a fantastic deadly shot opportunity so far. So yeah, sure. A 1 extra turn on your giant to play around the danger of deadly. I like it.
Yep. And Infested Wolf, not the worst draw possible. It goes well with the mana that he has available by playing that quick shot alongside it. And if RDU picks up something like a high main on his next draw, he's totally still in this game.
Plays out the Wild Growth, I think influenced a little bit by the fact that he drew Nourish that turn, realized that he's not going to need that Wild Growth to cycle late in the game, just uses it to gain the mana, and an 8-8 on the board thanks to the extra discount from the Wild Growth.
High main.
That is a Savannah High Main from the Barnes. RDU doing his best seems good impression right now, trying to hide his delight.
Yeah, that's the second best minion that he can get from that. The best would have been Ragnar's to Fire Lord, but still amazing. He's definitely happy with that result.
Sure is.
Double Feral is that's so much damage.
It really is, yeah. So does he ever have a world where he gets to go face here? If he goes face, he puts RDU to 16, and then he has 14 from hand. Is that like right? 12-14, yeah.
I think that's a pretty good play potentially with just like Feral raising the Barnes and going face with that. With that giant, then he puts his opponent on the 16, and yep. with the second Feral Rage and the swipe, he could end the game on the following turn.
Yeah, that relies on the Arcane Giant connecting with face again, but he's relying on that anyway. He's just a little bit short in terms of pure damage from hand yep. right now, I think. Maybe with the hero power over the two turns as well, he has lethal from hand?
I don't think he wants to swipe here, but just because that high main is much less threatening as a 1-1 right. than as the 2-1-1s.
I think if he did just want to go for a direct lethal setup, he could just push some damage this turn with one hero power and then follow it all up with the damage and another hero power on the next turn with an innovate. But he's going to take a more conservative line and just gain the life, try and push through the hard way.
Oh, that's still going to be good enough. Like, RDU did not find an additional point of damage, so
yep.
there's no trade available for that, that giant. And Pavel is about to go up 3-0 in the series.
Yeah, no hesitation from Pavel. This is a huge amassed pile of damage in the hand from the Malygos combo druid. Not in the fashion you normally see him getting burst down. And normally it's Malygos and combinations of Moonfires and Living Roots, but Feral Rages and Swipes with an 8-8 on the board do the job just fine as well. And now, I don't want to say it, but HCT caster predictions are infamously terrible. And by the clean sweep of a 4-0 RDU pick from our panel, have we cursed the man that has played the best Hearthstone okay. I've seen in a long time today? Go on,
let's break the curse.
Sure.
I'm going to predict that Pavel is going to win the series.
Do you know what? I agree with you, Savitz. I think that is a very, very good call, and we will be able to find out if that comes to fruition right after this. Two players in the grand finals going through drastically different emotions right now. For RDU, he is seeing 9 months of hard work, as has been mentioned by so many people, perhaps more hard work than anyone else puts into the game. He's seeing it all crumble away for him, whereas from Pavel's perspective, that prospect of redemption is within reach. He can finally, maybe when people hear the name Pavel, they won't think about Dr. Boom and Sylvanas anymore. They'll think about the guy that qualified for BlizzCon in 2016. We will see. It's going to come down to Pavel picking up a win with his C'Thun warrior here. Saviz, I don't know about you. I feel like he's got a great chance.
Definitely Pavel on the driver's seat here. The C'Thun warrior is fairly strong against all of the remaining decks from RDU. This is the best matchup that RDU has available to him. The Hunter is pretty good against warrior in general. And especially if Pavel doesn't find some early cards, I wouldn't be surprised to see RDU just run away with the game.
That is a brutal looking opening from RDU here. This is exactly what he needs. Just a nice, yep, comfortable win in a favored matchup just to get him into this series so he can start operating. And Squire, whoa, into Sticky Minion, into Bow, into Bar. Like, this is so much damage output here that he might just be able to run this matchup over.
Yeah, and Pavel, no play for turn two there. He does have the ghoul now, but he doesn't really do all that much. He might just have to, like, armor up and shield slam. I don't know. Feels so bad.
It does feel terrible, but really, how long can you sit around taking 3 damage a turn from this huge toad? I don't think it's a reasonable prospect, so he is just going to go ahead and shield slam here, but the hits are just going to keep on coming here from RDU. He can choose to develop this in any way he sees fit, and that is a perfect draw.
Let's just play the Harper. Wait, what?
Harper broke. You're just going to have the stats instead, but looks like that is still going to get to connect with face right now, so yeah, no harm done in it not having the charge. He might as well take the extra stats in this situation, although there's a decent chance the Huffer would have got to hit twice if it was a Huffer. So.
Oh, yeah, it actually would have, yep, as we can see, Pavel's hand. RDU here with a bow, that's pretty good cleanup for that, and with those 2 drops and no high main to save the coin for, I think it's going to coin out another 2 drop, just to, like, add some more pressure on the board.
I like it. He's going into the Brawl turn, but there's definitely no disaster if Brawl was to come out this early. There is the Brawl being drawn. Yeah. I would have liked to see the coin 2 drop there, I think, but RDU might just be holding onto the coin here. He does have a lot of high-cost drops in his deck, Ragnaros, as well as double Call of the Wild, I believe. Still at 9 mana, he's one of the players in this tournament playing 2 of them. So.
Yep, and even though he didn't have anything to coin out, really, the next turn with it, no high main, no Ragnaros to save it for, no Call of the Wild to save it for. He might pick up one, it's very likely. And here, Houndmaster. It's a little bit of a... It's kind of a lot of eggs in one basket here. Execute would be pretty nice on that Misha, but still not too bad. Even if the execute was to happen, it does cost 2 mana nowadays. So there would still be a good amount of power remaining on the board.
Yeah, and no secrets in RDU's list, so no danger in using the bow up there, no lost value in terms of generating extra charges. Pavel is just going to try and tank this game from behind, quite literally with the tank up, and he's going to take a ton of damage, but just hope he can bounce back in the late game, but it's not looking pretty for him right now.
Not at all. RDU has to think about if he wants to play around revenge here or not. Because that is something, if he went face with everything and hero powered, Pavel would go down to 11 HP, and in that case, it would be quite powerful.
Oh. Wow.
So that's a good insurance against Brawl, I would say.
Yeah, that means RDU can just go all in here if he wants to. This is a straight decision whether he values the two damage from the hero power or whether he wants another minion on the board. And RDU has decided it's straight up face hunter time, and he's going in there with the hero power. Pavel has to panic Brawl here, no choice, but it's not looking like it's going to be enough, especially not now. That is 19 health facing 10 damage straight away on the board. Call of the Wild now drawn that can be played next turn due to RDU saving that coin. This is exactly what RDU is going to need to get back into this series.
Yep, and it's also going to build up a lot of confidence. Just getting that one, just take it one by one. It wouldn't be the first reverse sweep that we've seen on HCT.
So Kindly Grandmother comes down again, playing around things like Revenge, like Brawl number 2, just to make sure that he's able to maintain the biggest board presence he possibly can. And with Call of the Wild coming down next turn now, every minion that sticks to the board is an extra point of damage getting amplified by that Leok.
Yeah, I'm kind of playing into revenge here a little bit, I suppose, but there's still that Misha, he wouldn't even die to that, and there's still the kindly grandmother, so
yep.
I don't think there's anything that could go wrong, and we can see that Pavel's hand is not too great. Ooh, shield block.
Shield block takes him to 12, tank up takes him to 16, and the execute on the Misha means that there will be 3, 6, 8, 10, 15. Yeah, that's just an enormous amount of damage. Yeah. I think it's 20 damage.
There's only room for two minions from the Call of the Wild, but the minions spawn alphabetically, so the Misha is going to be the one that does not get summoned.
Yep. So, get the ones that matter.
Yep.
So RDU just double-checking the maths here. Coin Call of the Wild. He's going to be plenty of damage with a board this wide. Leok buffing everything. Huffer getting in the charge attack as well. And Misha just left watching by the sidelines on this one. But Misha did his work earlier in the game after that turn three summon. I think he got to connect face every single turn after that turn three.
Yeah, that was incredible. That's very one-sided game right there. And RDU needs some more of that. That was the first step. And now he needs to take down that same deck. Three more times. It's going to get a little bit harder every time. I would imagine that RDU is going to play his decks in order where he feels like he's going to take his best matchups first. Kind of maybe build up some confidence and make Pavel nervous.
Well, here's my question then. What is the next best matchup for RDU? Because while we were on break, I said to you, these three matchups, Druid, Shaman, Warlock, there's no way C'Thun Warrior loses to all three of these. So in this situation, if you're going with the best matchups, what are you picking? Yeah. Awkward.
I guess Shaman.
Yep.
So here we go. Spirit Claws. Not like the greatest card against that, but likely still be a good card to keep. I mean, it is a one-mana play, so pretty nice Hex. That'll be good later on, but not in the starting hand. Pavel looking at a Fiery War Axe. Acolyte of Pain also not too bad.
Yeah, staring at that Fiery War Axe, looking into its eyes, caressing it. This could be the Fiery War Axe that sends him to BlizzCon at this point. Such a huge card to have in your opening hand in any board-focused matchup, but against Shaman in particular, because they are so snowball-y. Beyond any other deck in the game, they snowball early board presence into dominance better than anyone else. So Fiery War Axe to shut that down is huge.
It certainly is. Something like a turn one Tunnel Jock can be so impactful. It is incredible. Bloodlust. I mean, it's not necessarily a card that you want in your starting hand, but I don't think it's a bad card to have either. The Warrior tends to play a little bit greedy with those brawls and stuff. The totems are not that threatening. I think RDU has a very good chance to maybe take this, even though there is a good starting hand from Pavel.
Spell damage term right off the bat. Pavel going to choose probably just to War Axe this down and reduce any threat of that Spirit Claws interacting too well with his minions going forward, especially as he has quite a board presence heavy, minion heavy hand. So that spell damage totem buffing up the Spirit Claws is potentially of detriment to him, but he decides not to. He's going to leave the spell damage totem up on the board.
Yeah, that's a very interesting choice there. Now the Acolyte of Pain doesn't look so tempting because of that Spirit Claws. I guess he could play it anyway, just cycle that Acolyte. Just go for the C'Thun's Chosen.
Yeah, I don't hate this. C'Thun's Chosen, classically another class that it is strong against in Shaman, but the Spirit Claws really changed that a little bit, but still a three damage swing going to have to be used here if he wants to take care of the Divine Shield. But RDU might just choose to ignore it and operate on his own terms here, let the C'Thun's Chosen trade into his minions slowly one by one.
Good positioning there. In case that he got the Flame Tank Totem, he would have been able to trade both of his basic totems into that cartoonist cultist.
Yep, so it looks like RDU is considering the trade this turn, or at least the taking off the Divine Shield so it doesn't get full value out of that, but definitely some merit in pushing face here and being aggressive because it doesn't really reduce the I mean, I guess if he leaves it like this, the War Axe can go into the Taunt Tome, the Divine Shield can go into the 3-4. That's more value than he has to give to the C'Thun's Chosen. But RDU really considering what this charge of his weapon is worth to him right now?
I mean, I would like to see him punch that, but I don't know. I think it might be a close decision. He doesn't have another one in his hand right now.
It still really surprises me that Pavel allowed that spell damage totem to live early on. I understand the thinking that if you kill it now, he can just resummon it again and you've wasted your time, right? Like, if you wait and you deal with the spell damage totem on the exact turn you're scared of it being relevant, that minimizes your chances of it being around, but that opens you up to the world, which exactly what happened, which is Taunt Totem coming down and blocking that from ever being an option.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about the totemic might. Like, they got that the totem was going down anyway. This Ravaging Cool is going to be amazing for Pavel. It's going to finish off that. It does take his own minion's Divine Shield, so there's that. Yep. That it kind of backfires in that sense, but still very powerful.
Yeah, what the Totemic Might did is prevent that trade I talked about where the War Axe goes into the Taunt Totem and then the Divine Shield of the 4-2 goes into the barn. So he was trying to prevent that much Divine Shield value coming out from the C'Thun's Chosen. But Ravaging Ghoul is a nice clear up here anyway. Adi, you can only address one of these minions with what Pavel can see, but does have Lightning Bolt, plenty of other strong options in hand as well to take care of this.
Yep. And there's the Lightning Bolt. That's 4 more mana, so think from below. It's going to hit the board right now. Pavel has a Shield Slam for it, but no armor. Disciple of C'Thun, however, that's probably going to be used. He does have Shield Block.
He has Shield Block, Shield Slam, yeah. Yep. Disciple of C'Thun into Execute is a far more universal activator. For example, you know, Shield Block, Shield Slam doesn't take care of a Thunder Bluff Valiant, whereas Disciple and Execute does, so I like him using that order. Also digs him one card deeper into a deck where his hand is looking a little bit suspect right now. Thunderbluff just dropped on the board, and Pavel's hand picks apart this one-by-one minion strategy of RDU right now. It gets picked apart very well by Pavel's hand.
That's an easy Shield Slam right there. Even if there was a Ragnaros from RDU coming later, he still has that Execute. And not only that, but he has 3 more mana, so he can get his own Acolyte on the board right now. And RDU needs something like Mana Tide to keep himself sustained here on cards.
Goes for the totem first, doesn't hit the spell damage, so he is going to have to commit the Blood Mage Thaunos here. Probably needed to do it anyway because his hand is running dry, but takes care of the Acolyte to prevent any excessive draw there from the Acolyte. There's the first Brawl. Those are huge cards in this matchup. You need to be as greedy as possible. The Ravaging Ghoul draw is enormous, though, paired with that Execute. Moving forward, he has so much removal to burn now. Bran, Disciple of C'Thun, just another removal option, then curving into that Ancient Shieldbearer to gain him life.
Yeah, and Totemic Might not going to help. Miles from Portal, is there a worse top deck for RDU? Maybe he gets at least a Spellpowered Totem.
Nope.
That is
two useless, ineffectual card, and you are looking at the face of a potentially broken man here, a man on the brink of falling apart. He's worked so hard, and he just feels this slipping away for him. He can't generate any pressure. Pavel has all the plays available to him. Disciple of C'Thun, sorry, coming down for the double buff now, meaning that Shieldbearer is immediately active.
It's going to be 20 armor if RDU can't remove the Brand.
Yep.
And I don't think he can. Like, how are you supposed to remove that right now? Totem Golem.
Totem Golem not going to do it. I think he would have needed Lightning Bolt number 2. That would have been a reasonable turn. Bolt the 2-4 and Maelstrom Portal again.
Well, that's good. At least they got the best Totem.
Sure.
It might not be enough, but it was at least something. And here we go. 20 armor for Pavel. Unless he picks up something even better. Nope.
Unless he draws a better card than 7 mana 6-6, gain 20. Yeah.
That's pretty tough. Yeah, let's be real. And almost at 60 health right now.
I mean, the good news for RDU is that if he can actually gain a grip on this board, you know, kind of irreversibly, the health doesn't really matter. If you can just have a couple of turns beating away for 6 to 8 damage and then finish it all up with a huge Bloodlust at the end, you are capable of bursting down huge amounts of damage against Warrior. The bad news is that he has to beat 2 Brawls and a C'Thun to be able to do that, and his hand is just not equipped. Pavel is looking in incredibly good shape here. RDU needs to cycle this Drake into Hex right now.
Yeah, if he gets the Hex, I guess he still has a small chance. The Taunt Totem would maybe help a little bit here. Doesn't even get that, so Pavel, 1 damage off right now.
Yeah, and RDU just gonna give it up. Even in a game of this importance, he knew that he was beaten, and Pavel is going to be our final competitor from the Europe region at BlizzCon. RDU, I think you played like an absolute champion today, but just fell a little bit short. And for Pavel, no slouch himself. Incredible stuff from him. And now, maybe, after I do it one final time, people will stop talking about that misplay.
Yeah, I think now there's something that Pavel will be remembered for, which is not negative. He played so well all day long and very well-deserved win. I feel a little bit bad for RDU. I feel like maybe he was getting a bit nervous there. There was some stuff, especially in the first game, just seeing how he played the life tap last. That's something that I really don't see RDU usually do, but all credit to Pavel. Well played.
Yep, so just taking a look at his road here, obviously taking out Hoi in the first round, the quarterfinals, then defeating George C, and then RDU. I mean, is there a run through this tournament that is possibly tougher than that in terms of, you know, notoriety in the scene? Those are potentially the three biggest names in the tournament, and Pavel, like a one-man Russian wrecking crew, has taken them all down.
Yeah, it was quite convincing in every single series, too.
Yeah.
That's quite something. I was expecting like George C or RDU maybe going all the way. Pavel like could have like maybe semi-finalist or like a second place finisher, but right. I got proven wrong. He brought his unique decks and he did well with those.
Yeah, I think potentially I was looking at an RDU George C final perhaps, but Pavel was the bracket buster here. He made a great run and with a unique and innovative lineup as well, with the Dark Arakoas in his Druid, the C'Thun Warrior that no one else was really bringing, the Tempo Mage list that no one else was bringing. You know, he's done it his way here, and he's shown that with a little bit of care and attention and bringing something just a little bit out of the ordinary in a fresh meta like this, you can get yourself an edge over the opponents. And these are those closing moments yet again where Pavel was just getting in a more and more dominant position on the board, and RDU could just feel it all slipping away from him turn by turn.
Yeah, it's just getting worse and worse. The Brand Bronze Spear doing so much work. 20 armor buys Pavel so much time. Even if he didn't get the cartoon just yet, he would have had very, very many turns more to still get it.
Yeah, and that is the face. This is the final moment right here. C'Thun comes down. Drake is picked up. Needed to go into the Hex for RDU. No such luck. So he gives it up, recognizes the situation as untenable, even though Lethal wasn't on board. But standing by to tell you more is Frodan.
We have our last qualified spot going to Pavel from Russia. That wraps up the Europe region for a wonderful 2016 year, being able to defeat his opponent 4-1 in what is one-sided series, deciding his fate to BlizzCon. Pavel is joining us for a couple of words on his victory, and we're going to get him on the line very shortly. So I think he's joining us right now. Pavel, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Ah, awesome. Well, congratulations on your victory. What's it feel like to qualify for BlizzCon?
Yeah, thank you. Have awesome feelings. I was work for it in entire year, so
yeah,
very glad about that.
Yeah, definitely. You had a lot of ladder qualifications and open cups. You brought a very different strategy with very weird choices. Can you explain why you brought certain things, like why Tempo Mage, for example?
Yeah, I think my strategy was just bring five the best decks. Don't try to counter anything, because with five decks format, it's very hard to build all your five decks to counter one special deck, which is popular. So I bring Tempo Mage, because I think this is just one of the strongest decks. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely. And I think you did a very good record with it, being able to win very flawlessly. You won very convincingly against RDU. Did you feel like you were very favored against RDU?
I think my lineup is a little bit favorite against his lineup. I think the most important win for me was against Hoish. I think his lineup was a little bit favorite against my lineup, because he had Harrison in all his decks except Rhino Lock. But in Rhino he have combo with Leroy and Ushi, so all his decks is good against Rogue. Yeah, I think it was the most important win for me.
Yeah, it's interesting. Not many people say they're afraid of Reno Warlock, but you even pointed out, so that's a pretty cool shout out there. You're part of the Russian community, and you know we want to learn more about how the Russian community has developed. So is there any group of players that you've practiced with to help you get to this point and be successful?
Yeah, I'm practice with players like Shtan Udachi, like Nick Chipper. He isn't Russian, but he is Ukrainian, but Ukrainian also speak Russian, so...
Sure.
Also, talk with Dr. Hippie about some decks. And with other good players from Russia.
Awesome.
Not only.
Yeah, well, congratulations, Pavel. We'll see you at BlizzCon. And congratulations on your victory. We'll see you in about a month.
Thank you. We'll see you.
I do want to give a personal shout out to Pavel. He knows that English is not his best language, but he attempted his best to communicate, and I think we got a lot out of that, being able to just give a shout out to his fellow players who've helped him practice, people who've qualified for BlizzCon like Dr. Hippie, as well as other people within the Russian-speaking community, whether Ukraine, Russia, or that region as a whole. It's been a fantastic journey just to go through all of Europe. Everyone pegs Europe as one of the strongest, if not the strongest region currently in the competitive Hearthstone, but that wraps it. But we're not done yet. We have two more last calls to go through. Tomorrow, beginning at 9 p.m. Pacific, we're going to have 8 players from the Asia-Pacific region, ranging from Korea, Japan, New Zealand, all these other places. It's going to be really exciting to see who is going to go through as the last spot, as well as America's on October 15th at 9 a.m. Pacific. Make sure to mark those calendar dates. We've got all kinds of great players coming from different points of the globe. Who's going to get those last favorite spots that people have been looking for as a year's worth of hard work all boils down to these last points of competition? As with such, let us know what you guys thought of the games as well. Hashtag HCT on social media. Tweet at us at PlayHearthstone or Facebook.com/Hearthstone. I'm Frodan from the rest of the casters. We see you guys tomorrow night for Asia Pacific's Last Call Invitational. Until then, have a good night and stay out of trouble. See you soon.